This Tuesday, the church will be taking the seniors to Sirloin Stockade. We'll be leaving here at the church about 10 a.m. Anybody is welcome to go. Church pays for all the seniors. That's 60 and up. So, if you can be here and want to be a part of that, that'd be great. So let's remember that. The 4th of July, we'll be starting around 6 o'clock. That week, we'll have our service along with that on Tuesday night. We will not have a Wednesday night service that week. We'll do it all on Tuesday. I will like to inform you that the fireworks are in my house, so they won't get hot and cold. If somebody goes by there and drops a match while I'm sitting there, y'all see me going by Mars. I think we're going to have an unbelievable display. So.
Yeah, so we invite everybody.
Yep, invite your neighbor. Anybody wants to come, welcome. Then, here's a ministry opportunity. The youth church camp will be held July the 7th through the 9th at the Hill in Hardin, Kentucky. The cost for each person is $70. Kids are asked to pay half. If you would like to sponsor a child, please get with Troy or Rhonda by July the 2nd. If you cannot do the whole amount, want to help, donate what you can. If you cannot sponsor a child that wants to help, here are some ways. It says just pray, pray, pray. And there's a sign-up sheet in the back for food needed for the weekend. And if you want to come serve, help in some way during the weekend, get with Troy and Rhonda on that. I will tell you when and where to be. It says we appreciate your support, but most of all, your prayers. Pray that God changes hearts and saves souls. And there will be no women's Bible study this week, so remember that. Also, we need to continue to remember that was on our prayer request list. I talked to Johnny Perham. Kathy made it through her procedure real well. But he has got this virus that's going around. Jeannie knows about it. It's gone through her family. And, so we want to remember them. He's got that. And let's hope that Kathy doesn't get that. Because at this particular time, she definitely does need that. Continue to remember Julia. We got different ones that need prayer requests, and Sharon, different ones, and David and Diana. It just goes on and on and on. So I ask you to remember all these. Any other special announcements or prayer requests? Nothing else. Brother Dennis, lead us in prayer.
Lord, precious Heavenly Father and God Almighty, we come to thank you, Heavenly Father, this morning. We pray, Lord, that Heavenly Father, we thank you in our heart. We ask now for the first question, Heavenly, before we ask anything of you. Pray, Lord, and all the things that you have already done. We thank Heavenly Father, we ask you to sing now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Good morning, church.
Glory.
Good to see all of you this morning. Hope you've had a good week this week. Enjoyed the last semi-pool here. Looks like we're going to have for a little while. Looks like summer is fixing to set in. All right. up and down, ready to praise, and thank Jesus, he's worthy of our praise. Start out this morning, because you are not king.
You, my king, would die for me. Just be aware of those things that are going on there.
You said 100?
could handle the husband, get that far?
Yeah, I'd rather about that. Yeah.
How many do you? I know better than that.
No, I didn't, I ain't one. I don't know, the time I got into it, I didn't really do anything, I just watched it. But anyway, it was really good. We let those guys cook, that are there, that are trustees, and they trust him to come out and cook with us. And a lot of those guys, they go to church with us when we go in there on Sunday nights. Those same guys are the ones that are always there, faithful, wanting to help and wanting to do things. So it gives him an opportunity to give back to the community too. And so I thank God for that. Anyway, let's proceed the offering this morning. James didn't hear this morning, did
he? James
didn't hear. James didn't hear. I need one more
prayer.
Here comes Tom. Let's go with you. All right, would you stand with us this morning? Our Father, we thank you this morning. Lord, I thank you for a church that's so active, doing so many things. Lord, our Sunday school, I thank you, God, for all the classes we have, the teachers, Lord, as they teach your word. What a blessing it is to be able to go to Sunday school. For our worship service, this service, God, I ask you to meet with us here. God, just pour out your spirit on this place today. Lord, we talked about giving this morning and reaching out and doing things. And Lord, we're giving a portion of what you blessed us with. And Lord, we want to be cheerful givers today and not expecting anything, God. We just want to glorify your name in this offering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. This week, I'd ask you to pray for Miss Glenda. Glenda Mitchell, she's over here. She's going to have a total knee replacement on Wednesday. So remember, lift her up in prayer on Wednesday, please. Miss Kathy Barron had an oblation done in St. Louis last Thursday or Friday. She's home and doing well. I hope she's watching today. Kathy James and her daughters, her and her husband Randy are down there with their family, and she sent us a message and thanked God for us, and to be here in spirit. She loves our church. Wheel of Fortune. Anybody older as I am? I wanted to make mention that there was a young lady there yesterday on Wheel of Fortune that had lived in Moore Park for 25 years. Yeah. I had 4 or 5 children. I just wondered if she went to church with you. All right. For those of you visiting with us, y'all didn't give enough money, so we're going to send them around again. No, I'm just kidding. We take up a change offering every Sunday, and we use this change offering at the end of the year. People submit names that for their children, or people, maybe a family they know that's not going to have much of a Christmas, and we use this change offering to get their Christmas for them. And so we helped something like 20 or 25 families last year with just this change offering. So God has done an amazing thing for us. Let's pray. Father, once again, we thank you, Lord, for the ability to give to this change offering. God, what a blessing it is to see those little children, God, as they receive those gifts coming from you, Lord, from a cheerful, giving heart. Thank you, Lord, for this blessing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. been blessed with this week. Oh, he's been so good. He sent us a little rain when we needed it most. Bubba, yes. Yes, remember Bubba, Lola's son, he's back on his feet. Still having trouble on his leg, he's trying to work and get by. Remember Joseph, I think Joseph is going to Ireland, is that right? Or Jan Gray, yes.
Through it all, my eyes are.
Amen.
Our praise team got along with our new one for the lesson. Congregation, some of y'all know it, has this new disease, y'all can sing along with it.
Five, are we on, Alan? Heaven's Jubilee, is Bill going to have that on there? We're going to have that on the screen, Heaven's Jubilee. We're going to turn it into some nice prayerful songs.
Something very, very sweet and soft and spiritual to some good old gospel, Heaven's Jubilee. I love these old songs. You know, I want you all to clap and sing. And you know what? I am so excited to get to heaven someday. Can I hear an amen? Right? Okay. So, all right, like it's like really fun down here. Okay, this is God's little playground for us, and we all love it. However, I am really looking forward to my mansion in heaven where you don't have to do any yard work out in 98 degrees. Okay? That's number one. I'm also asking the Lord, please put my mansion by my best friend of 45 years next to her mansion so we can talk 24/7. Okay? And also, I want to be in the choir with my Aunt Rita up there singing. Okay? Aunt Rita, we love you and we miss you. And I know she's up there waiting for us. So let's sing Heaven's Jubilee. And let's put some real oomph into it, okay? Come on, y'all. All right, here we go. Oh, 258. Also, if you want to use the book, one more time. All right.
Yeah.
today. In Psalm 22, David, the writer of Psalms, was excellent at his describing, and I always look for, the Jews call it a remish. It's called a hidden message. And I'm always looking for the hidden message in a lot of these verses in Psalms, because there's a lot in here. And if you really look at Psalms, I'm in 22, but if you want to take a look at that sometime and look at Psalms 22, this was written 1,000 years before Christ was born. But yet in chapter 22, we find a picture of Jesus on the cross. David wrote it, and he intended for us to get it. And yet a lot of people read it, and they don't get it. They don't see it. Chapter 22 is a picture of Jesus going to the cross, covering your sins and my sins, taking on the sins of the world and dying on that cross, birthing the church that you're a part of today. That's in chapter 22. In chapter 23, we see him on the cross in 22. But in 23, we see him as the shepherd of that church and the shepherd of that flock, following right along beside you and me. And he restores my soul, the Bible says. David wrote it right there for you in chapter 23. And in chapter 24, in 22, we see him as the suffering servant on the cross. In 23, we see him as the shepherd of the flock. In chapter 24, we see him as the God of glory. You need to read your Bible sometimes, folks. There's hidden messages all throughout those verses for you. And he's got a great message for you. What is the message, preacher? That he died and he rose again on the third day. He paid for your sin. He paid for my sin. And bless God, he's alive today and well, still on the throne. But in 22, in verse 6, let me read it. I'll start at the beginning. You remember this verse, the very first verse. Jesus said it on the cross. In chapter 22, verse 1, my God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? Oh, my God, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not, and in the night season am not silent. But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in thee, they trusted in thou, and thou didst deliver them. They cried unto thee and were delivered. They trusted in thee and were not confounded. But verse 6, listen to this. But I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men and despised of the people. All they that see me laugh to scorn. They shoot out the lip and they shake the head, saying, he trusted in the Lord that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighted in him. But thou art he that took me out of the womb. Thou didst make me whole when I was upon my mother's breast. I was cast upon thee from the womb. Thou art my God from my mother's belly. But not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help. Father, this morning, as we look at these verses in chapter 22, we see the hidden message here of you on the cross. Now I know many are here this morning and they've heard the words that I just read and they still are not seeing the cross. But God, help me this morning. I need your help today. I need you every second of my life. But Lord, this morning I want you to help me draw and paint this picture for your people that they can see you in these verses today. Who you really are. The Lord of the universe. The one that came from heaven and died on a cruel cross so that we might gain access into the heavens. Oh God, we thank you today for who you are tonight. but yet you said, I am not over. Thank you. In Jesus' name. In some instances, Jesus refers to himself as many different things. In some of the verses, he refers to himself as the Lamb. In a lot of verses, he refers to himself as a lion. In some verses, he uses the term turtle dove. Some of the verses he used as a brazen, a bronze snake, if you will, lifted up high among the people, and many different things that he refers himself to. But in this particular verse, we see that he refers to himself. He said, I'm not a worm. Now, he's not referring to a earthworm in the sense that you and I would refer to a worm. But if you will look at this word, worm, that he uses and describes himself here, is talking about what we know, if you study that, is called the total worm. It's common in Israel, and it's significant. The total worm is the worm that they use to extract the scarlet dye to fit the royal robes of majesty, and it's used for a lot of other different reasons, but it signifies the red blood of Jesus Christ. Its color is the same. So, if you study the life cycle of the total worm, that's where you'll find the greatest picture of grace that you'll ever see. You say, preacher, what are you talking about? The total worm is a female worm that lives its life to die birthing a baby. Let me say that again.
Come on.
Y'all been getting this.
Yeah. Come on.
It lives its main all purpose in life is to come and live its life and give birth to a family. But watch this. When the total worm knows it's time to give birth to a family, it's a perfect time in that worm's life. It goes to, they call it Kimmer Oak. But it goes to a tree. And it crawls upon that tree, puts itself on the tree, and attaches itself to the tree. Are y'all hearing me? At the perfect time, it does that. When it senses that it's the time for it to get on the tree, it goes willingly and goes and crawls up on the tree and attaches itself to the tree to give birth to his family. Yeah. Hey, can I remind you that my Jesus, in his perfect time of God, went and climbed up on the cross and attached himself. They didn't drive those nails. He willingly accepted those nails in his hands and his feet. Yeah. He placed himself on the cross because he knew that it was God's perfect time.
That's right.
This worm, is red, scarlet red in color. The atoning blood of Jesus Christ is scarlet red. Why do you think when Rahab the harlot asked how they would know where she was, and the people of Israel told her, said, if you'll let down that scarlet thread that you let us down with, we'll know which house is yours. Yeah. We can tell by the scarlet cover. Can I tell you today that if you're a child of God today, what God is looking for in you today is the scarlet thread of redemption, the blood of Jesus Christ that covers you and covers you for all eternity. That's what he's looking for. That total worm crawls upon that cross at the appointed time. It attaches itself to that tree. The only thing that keeps that toll worm attached to that tree is the love that it has for the family that it's going to birth.
Amen.
Let me say it again. The love is what held the toll worm on the tree because it was fixing to give birth to his family. And by the same token, Jesus Christ was held on the cross. He could have called 10,000 angels and they could have come and got him off that cross. But yet, love held him on the cross because he loved you and I that much. Love held Jesus. The toll worm crawls upon that tree. And love holds him there. And during the birthing process, the toll worm gives birth to its family. It forms a hard shell, a protective shell, where nothing could get in the way of birthing that family. Oh, listen to me. Satan wanted to bust his bubble. Satan wanted him to come off the cross. Satan wanted him to die. But yet, there was nothing in all of eternity that could have stopped the progress of Jesus going to the cross. It was God's redemptive plan from day one, before he even created Adam and Eve, before he created you and I. It was the plan of redemption for you and I. And that plan of redemption is still being carried out. He went to the cross. He went to the grave. He rose on the third day so that you and I could be birthed into the kingdom of God.
Amen.
The toll worm is a worm. It does a lot of things. In that protective bubble, if you will, the hard shell, the toll worm lays its eggs. And in the process of laying the eggs inside that shell, it secretes a crimson scarlet gel fluid that covers those babies.
Amen.
Listen to me.
Yeah.
And they never lose their crimson color for the rest of their life. They remain crimson because they've been covered on the tree. Can I tell you this morning that the reason you're covered this morning, that the reason you're covered in the scarlet blood of Jesus Christ is because you were birthed on the same tree. You were birthed by the same Savior, and the same blood was shed for you and me. I'm telling you today, there is no other way but the blood of Jesus Christ. That toll worm covers his children. And it leaves a stain. Listen, it leaves a stain on the side of that tree that it climbs upon that can never be removed. You can't wipe it off. You can't brush it off. Now watch this. That toll worm crawls upon that tree. And the people that secrete the sun, they gather that scarlet fluid. They've got a window. They've got 3 days. Listen to me.
Come on.
They've got 3 days to go in there and get that fluid, that scarlet blood, if you will, out of that water. Because on the fourth day, glory
to God. Come on.
Yeah.
On the fourth day, that scarlet worm, that crimson worm, on the fourth day, if they haven't extracted it, it dries up and it becomes white as snow. It turns bottom white on the fourth day. And listen, the righteousness of God. Listen to what Isaiah said. He says, come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be like crimson, they shall be like wool. I'm telling you today that crimson worm, when he climbs up on that tree, he's there for
that total work. 3 days, and on the fourth day, that substance that they secrete, you know why they want that stuff? If you remember, when the 10 lepers came to Jesus, and they needed healing, they were dead, they were dying. Leprosy was a symbolic of sin. They were dying from within. What did Jesus tell that one that turned back and thanked him? He told all of them the same thing. He said, go and show yourself to the priest. What did the priest do? He took scarlet and hyssop and cedar wood and cleansed that leper. That same scarlet is what they used in the cleansing process for the lepers. That same scarlet was used in the sanctifying of the house. Why do you think he said when he instituted the Passover, he said, take the lamb and take it on the inside and eat it tonight. And when you get done, he said, take that scarlet blood and put it on the doorpost, because I'm fixing to pass over at midnight. And if I see the blood on your house, you'll be sanctified. You won't lose your firstborn. You're just going to get out of here. The same scarlet they used there was out of the scarlet blood of the lamb. Also, as I studied this, they used this same scarlet substance as a medicine. Guess what that medicine was for? It was for hearts that they didn't think was functioning. Come on, listen to me. A heart, somebody was having heart problems or heart seizure, something was going wrong with their heart, they went and they got this scarlet substance and they used it for medicine on their hearts. Oh, listen, the greatest medicine that you'll ever find, listen, you can go to the greatest physicians in the world, they can work on you 24 hours a day, but I'm here to tell you this morning, the only way that you can fix your heart filled with sin is to cover it with the scarlet blood of Jesus Christ and let Him change your heart. That total work. Now when they, I like this. If you were to go on the tree and you were to catch that total worm on the day that he turns white, they attested in this fact. Said if you would take that shell and pull it off the tree and crush it in your hand, it will give the sweetest odor that you've ever smelled in your life. Y'all didn't get that. Jesus was crushed on the cross for your sin, and He is the sweetest odor that you'll ever find on this face of the earth. He is your Redeemer. He's your kinsman. He's your Savior. He's your Father. He's all that you'll ever need. And by the way, He's the only thing you'll ever need.
Amen. Oh, listen. This total word. Are y'all seeing this picture of Jesus? In that one word, He said, I am but a worm. No wonder He called Himself a worm. Because He's talking about Himself on the cross here as a total worm, a scarlet worm, a crimson worm, if you will, willing to die for you and I. Listen, the worm is used for healing the regular heart. Jesus referred to this worm in this passage because He wanted you and I to know that David knew what He was talking about. You see what I'm saying now? There's a hidden message in chapter 22. There's a hidden message in chapter 23. But there ain't no doubt about chapter 24.
He explains that he is the God of glory. I have been from the time of beginning. I'm the Alpha. I'm the Omega. I always will be. I always am. I don't change. I'm still God all by myself. But I want you to see who I am in 22. I'm the man on the cross in 23. I'm the one that walks beside you beside still waters. How many of you know that sheep won't drink from troubled waters? They must have still waters in their life in order to drink. And the still waters that Jesus leads you in this life to, you can drink freely. It's called the living water. No wonder Jesus said, I am the water. He was painting you and I a picture of a scarlet thread of redemption in our lives. Oh, when I read this and I study this, I get excited. When I read that, and by the way, let me mention one other thing. I thought this was cool. When that worm dies on that tree, before it turns white, after its birth, its young, its tail curls up into the head, and it begins and it forms a perfect heart on that tree. We could just get that picture, folks. He died with a heart filled with his blood. No wonder that the Bible says when that Roman soldier went to Jesus and he pierced his side, what did it say came out? Water and blood. The crimson blood. And when that heart-shaped little worm is on that tree, Jesus is saying, that's me. That's the heart that I have for you. That's who I am. I went to the cross. Everything was predetermined in my life. When the perfect time came, I got on the tree for you. And when everything started to change, I gave birth to the church, and the church was born at the cross of Calvary. That's why we're here today, folks, to give glory and honor to the one that died on the tree. So next time you read these verses in 22, and you read 23, where he says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Remember those verses, because Jesus is painting you a picture. Listen to me. When you get ready to walk through the valley of the shadow of death, what is a shadow representing? It's a shadow. If a shadow's there, somebody's with that shadow. Somebody's making that shadow. And it's Jesus Christ who's walking through the valley of shadow of death with you. He's always with you. He'll never forsake you. And he's covered you with his scarlet ribbon. Yeah. Folks, it don't get no better than that. Jesus Christ said, I am the Lord. But oh, what a worm he is. He bled and he died to save your soul. But yet we sit here this morning. And we say, no thanks, preacher. I'm good just like I am.
Come on.
You go ahead and stay that way and see where it gets you.
That's right.
I can tell you where it's going to get you. It's going to carry you straight to a place called heaven.
That's right.
He said, preacher, you shouldn't use that language. That's not my language. That's Jesus. He spoke more about hell than he did heaven. He was warning you and I. You better get on the narrow path. The Bible says broad is the way to destruction. Narrow is the gate, and few there be. Are you one of those few? Have you found the gate to heaven? You'll only find it in the person of Jesus Christ. He did shed his blood for you and I. He did die for our sins. He did rise on the third day. He's your Savior. He's your only hope today. Do you know him? Are you trusting in him? Those people that watch those worms climb up on that tree, I wonder if they're reminded of Jesus now after they've seen that. If they trust in the Lord now, that they've seen the perfect picture of redemption in that little hole. I pray that you'll never look at that verse again after hearing this message today. Because because it's so true. Jesus gave his life. Come on, Rivers. I don't know where you're at today, but I can tell you this. In chapter 22, Jesus is the Savior on the cross. In chapter 23, he is the shepherd that walks beside him. In chapter 24, he is the God of all glory. Will he give his life? He sent his only begotten Son that you might be saved. Take him today. Let him come into your heart and save your soul. Would you stand? Do you know him today? Won't you come? Oh, you ought to thank him for that scarlet red blood that covers you for your entire life once you've accepted him. Have you got him? Does Jesus see his blood on you when he looks at your life? What does he see in you? Do we deserve that blood?
Thank you.
because I studied this week, and I looked at that. I looked at that total burn, what it drew up me a picture in my mind. Perfect picture of Jesus giving birth on the cross to his family. You're a part of that family today, for that very reason. Because Jesus did become that one. He willingly went to the cross. Willingly shed his blood. By the way, his blood is the best thing for your heart. Oh, how I love Jesus. And I know you do. God has been so good. Rock this mystery.
Maybe.